My name is Farhad, and I am project director in Samvad, which is a USAID-supported RMNCH project in India that uses community-based video approach to social and behavioral change communication on issues concerning maternal and child health, nutrition, and family planning. I want to welcome you in today's webinar on lessons from implementation and scale-up of Samvad project in 6 states in India. To talk on this topic and share the implementation and scale-up experience, we are privileged to have colleagues and friends from different partner organizations. These include State Livelihood Mission, National Health Mission, and our civil society partner, CYSD. In addition to that, we have our research and learning partner from London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. We are also delighted to have Ms. Sangeeta Patel, Director, Health Office, USAID. My colleague, Vijay from USAID, who is Reproductive Health and Family Planning Advisor in the India Mission, will share more details about the partners. Before moving on, I would like to give you a brief snapshot on today's webinar. We will start with the opening remarks from Ms. Sangeeta Patel, Director, Health Office, USAID. And then we will have a brief presentation from Mr. Krishnan Palasan, who is leading Digital Green in the capacity of Country Director, who would give us a sense of what Project Samvad is all about and how it is driving the change in terms of mobilizing the frontline functionaries to impact health and nutrition behavior and practices among the women in the reproductive age group and children. Krishnan would also be touching upon the evidences that support the community-based video approach. After the presentation of Krishnan, we would start the panel discussion and would hear the experiences of state and civil society partners about the experiences of Samvad implementation and scale up in their respective geographies. My colleague from USAID, Mr. Vijay Paul Raj, will facilitate the panel discussion. And then Dr. Sunita Kadiyal from the LHSTM would help us to summarize the panel discussion and share her experiences in evaluating Samvad project and what we have learned in this process so far. After the panel discussion and Sunita's summarization, we would open the floor for open discussion, and Vijay would take the questions from the partners and panelists and request the panelists to respond to that. I would request the participants to write their questions in the chat box during the course of webinar if they have any. But during the course of the presentation as well, we will encourage participants to share their thoughts and the questions if they have any, and they can write it in the question answer section. We'll try to respond as many questions as possible. I also want to share that a recorded version of this webinar would also be available, and Digital Green will share a link of the recording after the webinar is over. So welcome again, and to those who are joining now. Over to you, Vijay. Thank you.
Thank you, Farhad. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of USAID and Digital Green, I extend my warm welcome to all the partners and participants in this important webinar. Before we move on this webinar, it would be great to know more about our participants in today's webinar. So we will be posting 2 questions to know about your professional area of work and the region you belong to. These 2 questions will pop up on your screen. Please respond to them one after another. I would request Shiny to post the poll now. So Shiny, how long this will take?
Yeah, we're just ending in 5 seconds.
Okay. Yeah, it's done. Okay, so now you could see this on the screen. Largely, we are from the Asia region, and we have about 27% of us are public health professionals, 55% of us are development professionals, and 14% of us are M&E professional, and 4% of us are researcher. Thanks for joining in this poll. Yeah, so now I would invite Ms. Sangeeta Patel, Director, Health Office, USAID, for delivering the opening remarks. Sangeeta Patel is a US Senior Foreign Service Officer that assumed the duties of Health Office Director at USAID India on July 31st, 2019. Prior to this, she served with USAID in Pakistan, Zambia, Armenia, Namibia, and Washington, D.C. She has worked with USAID since 2000 on programs to promote health and education, strengthen health and social protection systems, further humanitarian assistance, and reach vulnerable populations. Before USAID, Ms. Patel worked with the Carter Presidential Center's Global Development Initiatives, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention Special Pathogens Unit at Atlanta, as well as the Peace Corps and German Development Organization in Madagascar. She has an MPH in Maternal and Child Health from Tulane University, a BA in French, and a BS in Biology from Pennsylvania State University. Over to you, Sangeeta. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vijay, and a huge welcome to everyone here today. It's a delight for me to be here in today's webinar organized by Digital Green, and really just being able to support you in sharing these experiences that we have at least had in community-based videos as a part of our approach to work on health and nutrition issues, particularly among rural women in India. For us, I'd start first off by thanking all of our partners, especially of the Samvad Project, who've really taken the time out of their busy schedules to be with us at this event. Let me start by recognizing Mr. Ravi Shankar Shukla, the Mission Director of the National Health Mission in Jharkhand, as well as Dr. Saroj Nathani, the Director of the National Health Mission in Uttarakhand, Mr. Balamurugan, the Chief Executive Officer of Jivika National Livelihood Mission of Bihar, as well as Mr. Jagad Nanda, the mentor and co-founder for the Center for Youth and Social Development, alongside the NGO partners, of course, in Odisha. I'm pleased that even Dr. Sunita Karyal, the Associate Professor for the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, is joining us today. The London School has been a strong monitoring and evaluation partner with us throughout this experience, and certainly I hope lend their wisdom as we look at the evidence-based data and the effectiveness of the community-based video approach, and of course other digital platforms. Through our journey with the Samvad Project and Digital Green, I certainly hope that we can show that we've demonstrated effective social and behavioral change communications. This tool and this approach through a pocket-sized Pico projector operated in a low resource setting is really one that's allowed us to disseminate videos and improve health and nutrition practices of women and children, really in the first critical 1,000 days of life. Today, Digital Green is disseminating the wealth of their expertise accumulated across states and really looks to the folks from Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Uttarakhand, and Assam really to be a part of this learning journey in informing how they reached over 700,000 women with maternal, child health, family planning, and nutrition related services and messages, and ultimately reached over 1.9 million women. The numbers are strong. In addition, we also supported 4,000 frontline community health workers through the National Health Mission, the Livelihood Mission, and the nutrition mission in these states, really being able to reach deep into the community and be able to work at the heart of the challenges faced by the community. Digital Green also really helped us to demonstrate the power of information and communications technology, digital platforms, even interactive voice response systems, WhatsApp, other medium, essentially that have proven to be essential, even beyond just the community-based videos, to be able to expand platforms and consider additional approaches throughout the pandemic to reach those most in need and be able to turn the tide ultimately on a difficult situation. Even as we face a second surge of COVID, I'm encouraged to see that all of our state government partners, the National Health Mission, the Livelihood Mission, the Nutrition Mission, all have demonstrated that it's critical to work at a community-based level and be able to apply approaches such as this video to be able to tell their own story, to adapt their own approaches, and ultimately, in a culturally appropriate manner, be able to work with frontline healthcare providers on ongoing outreach and support. This is a great opportunity, really, to consider, how to go to scale and how we sustain, even beyond what we're doing, these types of efforts. I think that for us, we've been proud to say that, especially with the Jharkhand mission, we've been able to work in a way on sustainability and really consider, even beyond the scope of Digital Green, how can this community-based approach continue to be applied in new geographies across the state. So for me, over the next 6 months, as the project winds to an end, I look to everyone here to consider ways in which we can support the state government to understand the depth of experience that has at least been amassed, and consider ways to adapt and approach what makes sense for you within your own setting. I'm looking forward to today's discussion and really thank you in advance for this participation in this webinar. I look forward to hearing the deliberations and seeing how we can make this become a sustainable journey. Thank you.
Thank you, Sangeeta. The next speaker, we have Mr. Krishnan Palasana, the Country Director of Digital Green, who will be presenting on the community video approach under Samvad project and the evidence base on it. Over to you, Krishnan.
Thank you so much, Vijay. Good afternoon, distinguished panelists, speakers, as well as those participants from different parts of the world. Welcome to this event to talk about the community-based digital videos approach of Digital Green. Next slide, please. Project Samvad started about 6.5 years ago. And the overall goal of the project is to contribute to improved maternal and child health in the geographies that where we are working. And what we are specifically trying to achieve of this initiative is to enhance the knowledge and behavior on nutrition, as well as on child health, plus the reproductive health, which is around modern contraception, through application of appropriate technology on ground. And the second objective that we have is also to build the capacity of our partners and help scale through institutionalization of this video-based approach into the ongoing programs on ground. Next slide, please. This project is working across 7 states in India: Bihar, Assam, Jharkhand, Odisha, 6 states, Bihar, Assam, Jharkhand, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, and Uttarakhand. And we are working in totally around 25 districts in those different locations that we have. And we are closely partnering with the different government institutions in those different states, In Bihar, it is with Jivika, with ICDS. In Assam, it is with NHM. In Jharkhand, it is with the Livelihood Mission, as well as NHM. In Odisha, also with Livelihood Mission and our NGO partner CVSD. And Chhattisgarh and Odisha, we are also working with the National Health Mission partners. In addition, we are also closely working with other institutions like Project Concern International, UNICEF, World Vision, etc. And our research partner for this project is London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. And the on-ground research is done by Center for Media Studies. And we are also have brought in Onion Dev and Smart as technology partners in this initiative. Next slide, please. Okay. What is the core to this approach? The community-based video approach, it's an empowerment process that is by the community, for the community, and of the community. So this video approach basically looks at identifying the local problems that are related to health and nutrition, and offer contextualized, localized, targeted solutions through videos that are generated by the people on ground. So these videos, when they talk about the solutions for this health and nutrition issues that are faced by people, the people are actually engaging with their own peers, understanding the subject in the language and the context that they know very well, and thus are able to engage and familiarize with them much better than any other form of outreach initiative. And there are some core principles that we apply when we do this. The first thing that we do is we listen closely to the people with whom we are working. So the community engagement comes as a part and parcel right from the design stage itself. We mobilize the community, listen to their to them, take ideas from them, and also identify who can be those local change agents in the community. And this listening to the people also helps us to understand the relevant topics that needs to be prioritized, and who are those local groups who can be involved in terms of mobilizing and engaging the community at the larger level. The second thing that we do is we do not create parallel structures. The key to our approach is our partnership. So we have been so privileged and honored to have partnered with National Health Mission as well as with Rural Livelihood Missions in different states, and working with them, facilitating this process, seeking their constant feedback, also guidance on the way forward, has been an enriching experience in itself. So instead of we creating separate structures on ground, we work with our partner structures and thereby helping them to improve their own systems efficiency. So that's the second thing that we do. And the third thing that we do is we collect a lot of data and we listen to that data very closely. And this data helps us in terms of not only identifying issues and coming out with appropriate content to address those issues, it also helps us to constantly update ourselves, update the content, and help us and our partner to take informed decisions as we move forward. So these are the three principles that we apply. We listen to people closely, we do not create new structures, and we listen to the data that we collect to help informed decision making. Next slide, please. And Samvad is a holistic approach. It involves different partners, different institutions, as well as community-based organizations in all the geographies where we are working with. So there are ICT partners and platforms that we are working with, including Mobile Vani, the community radio stations, the IVR systems, and use of digital platforms like WhatsApp, etc. We work with government partners, and through that government partners, work very closely with the frontline workers like ASHAs, Anganwadi workers, etc. We provide digital awareness through the video screening that we do on ground by identifying and working with the local resource persons and local champions. And this all leads to, by working with all these different partners on ground, we have been able to improve awareness among the community on health and nutrition issues, create a demand, and thereby also giving sufficient inputs and information to the supply side partners so that ultimately people are able to receive better service on health and nutrition related issues. Next slide, please. Over past 6.5 years, what have we achieved so far? We have reached more than 700,000 people with this RMNCH messages. And quite interestingly, in the last couple of years alone, thanks to COVID, that accelerated use of digital technology to reach out to people, more than 350,000, close to more than 360,000 people have been reached by WhatsApp or IVR in different states. And close to 2 million people have been indirectly reached through this approach. And as a part of this, we have been able to train over 4,000 frontline workers, including ANMs, ASHAs, et cetera. And they're acting as resource person who are trained on dissemination of this community-based video, as well as engaging with people in a much more proactive way. And there are also over 100 community-based video producers. That means the local people, either from the community structures we talked about, or young people from the community who have been trained how to produce videos, how to conduct formative research, how to conduct content development, script writing, and how to produce a video. So they are constantly working with our partners on ground. And so far, we have developed more than 60 videos in different languages. And these videos have been disseminated to these people more than 2,000 times over past many years. There are weekly schedules of this video dissemination that is happening on ground. And our research and knowledge partner, London School, have been facilitating what we call as a lean survey, around 6 to 7 cycles of lean surveys that were conducted in the past many years. And these surveys have given us significant feedback, including evidences on how the program is faring. And we have found that there has been significant improvement. For example, the use of modern contraceptives among women who are exposed to these videos, it increased from almost doubled in terms of increase over 2 years' time, from close to 19% to over 39%. And as I mentioned earlier, there's a significant investment that is happening in terms of use of digital media platforms to reach out to the people. Next slide, please. And what are these evidences? What do they say? Moving forward, we just to show you some of those very interesting data-based evidences that has come out. Okay, the early results of this community-based video approach have shown that there are 7 times more adoptions using the community-based video approach than over the classical extension. The classical brick-and-mortar extension used to be a combination of house-to-house visits, use of posters, pamphlets, and word of mouth information sharing. And this community-based video approach has actually significantly improved that adoption. And from the experiences both in agriculture sector, as well as in health and nutrition sector, has shown that the access to the extension service has gone from roughly about 13 to 14% about 8 years ago to more than 50% through this community-based video approach. And as you can see, 7 times more adoptions have been reported. And quite interestingly, an article that was published again during the initial years of this community-based video approach shows that there is a significant cost saving when we compare to the classic approach and the poster approach that we have on the information, education, communication approaches that we have. So there's a comparative advantage in pursuing or using a community-based video approach, both in terms of ability to scale, ability to adopt new practices, as well as in terms of costs. Next slide, please. We have also found through the lean surveys that we have been conducting that there is a significant exposure to a woman on the information that is being provided through the community-based video approach. So this graph basically shows the number of women who were exposed to the Samvad information state-wise. You know, there were about six rounds of lean surveys that we conducted, and this shows the state-wise information related to women's involvement. Next round, next slide, please. And the data from the lean survey also shows that there's a remarkable increase in the impact of the program on people who are exposed to Samvad approach and people who are not exposed to Samvad approach. For example, this graph shows a progression from July-September 2018 to October-December 2019. That's almost about 1.5 years. And you can see that there is a progression that is happening and the gap is also widening. That means that over a period of time, this particular example basically talks about recently delivered mothers having 4 or more ANC checkups. So the mothers who have been exposed to Samvad are taking the services much better than those mothers who are not exposed to Samvad information. And that gap is increasing as we move along. Next slide, please. This is another set of data that has come out, again, quite interesting during the same period. You know, mothers of children under 2 years who have correct knowledge of MIYCN practices in all the states. And we can see again, a big gap between those mothers who are exposed to Samvad videos, which is in the green line, and those mothers who are not exposed to Samvad videos who are in that gray line. So we can see again in the last 1 year or so, this gap is widening, which means that increasingly exposure to Samvad videos are actually impacting mothers positively. Next slide, please. Again, another example. This is on the women of reproductive age group of between 15 to 34 years who know about at least 3 modern family planning or spacing methods. And again, we can see that there's a big gap between those people who are exposed to the Samvad videos and those women who are not exposed to Samvad videos. Of course, the variances are because of various reasons, because of also the contextual reasons. But ultimately, we find there's a huge gap of knowledge between those who are exposed and unexposed. Next slide, please. So based on this, of course, the lean survey finding is, these are some of the examples that I tried to provide right now. And the lean survey has got evidences state-wise across different the topics that we are covering and also the overall program-wise. So we'll be very happy to share the finding with anyone who is interested to know more about the lean survey and the findings that we had. And a few weeks ago, we had a separate webinar that was conducted on showing the results of this lean survey from Samvad project, which was again facilitated by Professor Sunita, who is also in this webinar right now. Now, what are some of the key lessons that we have learned over a period of time? Okay, there are a number of lessons, but I would like to highlight 3 or 4 from those. The number one is that the Samvad program has actually once again highlighted the importance of community-based video approach in enhancing the overall efficiency and effectiveness of outreach for building social and behavioral change among the community. And we also have seen that this is cost-effective and this is a scalable approach. So this is once again, the project is highlighting the importance of this community-based video approach to build or to enhance social behavior change. The second is, as I mentioned earlier also, one of the most important aspects of this project, as well as this community-based video approach, is the partnership. The partnership at the center of whatever we are doing right now, and the partners have found value in not only in adopting this, but also scaling up this in different parts of their own geographies. Our partners like Jivika, et cetera, are significantly investing in scaling up this approach to all the districts across Bihar and other NSM partners are also following suit. They are investing in institutionalizing this approach, which is helping our partners to deepen as well as widen their interaction and engagement with the community. And as a part of this, our partners have also helped build the systems capacity, specifically the frontline workers who are empowered and they are able to utilize the resources available under this project, which is basically those Pico projectors and videos, to interact much better and much efficiently with their constituents on ground. And the third aspect that we would like to mention here is the power of technology. It's quite interesting that this community-based video approach that was launched about 8 to 10 years ago used Pico projector as the primary technology tool to reach out to community at large. And in the recent last 12 to 18 months, we have significantly invested in using other digital tools like WhatsApp, like IVR, like SMS messaging, etc., to reach out to the community. And we are finding that there's a huge interest among the participants. There's an uptake of the services through those digital platforms. And we find that in the days to come, there will be an increasing investment that will happen, not only from NGOs like ours, but also from our partners who are taking huge interest in use of technology to accelerate the development outcomes that they are envisaging on ground. So there are a number of lessons and learnings that we have identified and found out over the last 4 or 5 years' time. And some of the top two or three are what I mentioned right now. And over the course of the seminar, we will also be listening more to our partners and their experiences and what the challenges that they faced in implementing this program in their states at scale, right? Thank you once very much for participating in this. And we do wish all of you to have a wonderful interaction, a process of learning. And at any point of time, do reach out to us through the chatbot to ask any specific questions that you have. Back to you, Vijay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Krishnan. I think I would like to say that this project has come a long way. You know, I've been associated with this project from the beginning. Initially, when we started, we had a partnership only with the Livelihood Mission in Bihar. But then, you know, like very quickly, we saw the relevance of this approach in other, with other partners also, like the National Health Mission, the Nutrition Mission in Jharkhand, and also with ICDS. So the uniqueness of this approach is that how this approach, the community-based video approach, can be used among the frontline workers in different settings. And what is now so heartening to see is the result which we were able to monitor the impact of this approach through the lean survey that London School has been doing, has been partnering with us and doing this. And now we can clearly see how this approach has helped in improving the health seeking behavior of the women in the community. And I think this is a very impressive result, which actually makes a case for the partners in the state to scale this approach and to kind of, you know, invest more on this approach and to make this approach a part, an integral part of the outreach activity that the frontline workers are doing in every situation that they're doing, be it the National Health Mission, the ASHAs or the SAHIAS in the state, or the frontline workers in the Livelihood Mission, or the frontline workers in the ICDS, the Anganwadi workers, or the Nutrition Mission. So I think, thank you, Krishnan, for presenting this powerful presentation and also sharing all the results, which is actually building a big case for us to advocate in the state with the state government for scale and sustainability. Thank you so much. And as we move forward now, we will be starting the panel discussion. And we have a very powerful panelist for this panel discussion, the implementers at the state, the government implementers and the NGO implementers who have been doing this at the state level and who have seen the impact of this program at this, on the field. And we, Hainau, I'm happy to introduce Sri Ravi Shankar Shukla. Sri Ravi Shankar Shukla is a 2012 batch IAS officer. Prior to taking up the position of Mission Director in National Health Mission, Jharkhand, he had served as Deputy Commissioner of Latehar, Hazaribagh, and East Singhbhum District. During his stint as Hazaribagh's District Deputy Commissioner, his work on the cleanliness mission was appreciated at the national level, and Hazaribagh was on the top of the list in Swachhta ranking in Jharkhand and on the third position in India. The next panelist we have is Dr. Saroj Natani. Dr. Saroj Natani started her career in the health department in 1990s as an additional project director in the World Bank funded project. She also worked as director claims in Ayushman Bharat scheme. She has also served as chief medical officer of Rudraprayag and Haridwar district. At present, she is working as additional project director of Uttarakhand SATS and director of National Health Mission in Uttarakhand. She did her MBBS in 1982, from the prestigious King's George Medical College, Lucknow. Apart from a medical degree, she has also done postgraduate level course, healthcare management and quality of healthcare services. Thanks, Dr. Saroj, for joining us today. The next panelist we have is Sri Jagatananda, who's the mentor and co-founder of Center for Youth and Social Development, CYST, in Bhubaneswar. He was a state information commissioner and a member of the state planning board of Odisha. He was a visiting fellow of World Alliance for Citizen Participation and worked on the issues of legitimacy, transparency, and accountability within civil society at the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University, Cambridge, USA. Presently, he is a member of the Standing Committee for Civil Society Organizations and as an expert in the drafting of the National Vision of 2035 document at the Niti Aayog. The next speaker we have is Sunita Kadiyala, who's a professor of global nutrition and head of nutrition group at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. She's a nutritionist with research interest, focusing on the intersection between agriculture, food system and food security, gender and nutrition. Sunita's expertise spans program design, operations research, and theory-based complex program, impact evaluation, and innovative methods and metrics in agriculture e-nutrition research. She is the principal investigator of UPAVAN and co-principal investigator of SAMVAD evaluation. And now we have Vishal Vardhan, the senior executive producer at Digital Green. Vishal is passionate about filmmaking. Over the last 15 years, Vishal Vardhan gained vast experience in film direction, production, editing, scripting, and visualization of feature films, short films, documentaries, docudramas, and screenplay in different languages. He has experience in directing more than 80 films in different languages. Along with this, he has written lyrics for many songs, street plays, radio jingles, and dramas. Thank you, all the panelists, for participating. We were expecting Sri Balamurugan, the Chief Executive Officer of the Jivika, the livelihood mission of Bihar. He will be joining in a minute. But however, we have the representation from Jivika, Ms. Mahua Roy Chowdhury, who's representing Jivika. However, I will go ahead and introduce Sri Balamurugan. Mr. Balamurugan, an Indian administrative officer with over a decade of experience in the civil service of Indian national government, is academically trained in agriculture science and agri-management graduate from Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, Coimbatore. He is currently the Secretary, Rural Development Department, Government of Bihar, and old additional charge of Chief Executive Officer, Bihar Rural Livelihood promotion, popularly known as Jivika, the flagship program for poverty alleviation in the state. He is also the Commissioner, Self-Employment and Mission Director, Swachh Bihar Abhiyan. He has successfully led the governance and administration as district magistrate in districts of Jehanabad, Gopalganj, and Sivan. His contribution in the areas of digitization of social pension programs and his innovative solutions have resulted in significant development in the rural areas. So we now go forward and have the panel questions posted. Sorry, before that, I would request Vishal to share his thoughts around community video approach in improving the health and behavior of community. Vishal, over to you.
Thank you. Thanks for this opportunity to share my thoughts in this event. Actually, as a professional filmmaker in the social sector, I have learned that it's not easy to change the behavior of people, and it takes time and it's a continuous process. Our community-based video approach makes this difficult task easier. When we hear the term film or video, some scenes of Bollywood and Hollywood films cross our minds. But the purpose of this video we are talking about today is not just to entertain us, but to influence our thoughts and our behavior. Believe it, these videos do not have any less impact than Bollywood or Hollywood films on people's mind in the community. To promote community-based video, we provide training to video dissemination to the staffs and frontline workers of the partners organizations. During this training, we introduce them to every aspect related to video filmmaking, such as how to use the tools related to filmmaking, how different shots are taken, how to write scripts, how to edit videos, etc. And it's our endeavor that after this training, every participant is able to make videos themselves, by themselves. The biggest feature of this Digital Greens community-based video is that it's hyper-localized. The reason for this is that this video is made keeping in mind the need of the people who have to benefit from it. People appearing in these videos are also from the same community, and their language is also their own. When people from any particular community talks about their better future or benefit in their own language, only through this their people, then its effect in many times more than any other way. One special feature of this approach is that it can reach most people in short time. And there is uniformity in the message reaching out to the people. In other words, it's not only make the work of FLW easy, but also ensure that more people can get the benefit of their services. The community-based video approach has emerged as a powerful tool. Under this, by making small videos, we not only conveyed important information related to health of women and children, but it also showed a meaningful solution to the support and encourage the behavior change. Whether it is a matter of institutional delivery, it's a matter of importance of thought and age, or it's a matter of the use of iron pills. We have been successful in breaking the myths associated with these practices. Now the villages urge our FLWs to not only show the videos, but also suggest them to make videos on the new topics. In community videos, the ease of language, the appearance of people around you, and in-depth discussion by the facilitator while screening the video increases the trustworthiness among the people of that community. On one hand, and on another hand, people brings that change in themselves. After watching these videos, we have seen many people cleaning their hands and their children's before and after eating or after coming from toilets. There is also awareness among people towards family planning and ANC. In this era of social media, where mobile has reached every village and every household, the importance of community-based video increases even more. Because now you can easily reach to those who need it. During the pandemic, where it was difficult to reach people personally, very comfortably we delivered these videos to them through WhatsApp and get benefited. To conclude my thoughts, I would like to say that community video is a communication approach that engages local people in creating videos that represent their lives and concerns. This approach is highly empowering. Participants decide why and how to present different issues and what stories to tell and how to represent themselves and their community. It is a powerful tool to influence people's behavior. Thank you. Thank you very much. And over to back to Vijay.
Sorry, I was muted. Thank you, Vishal, for giving a brief explanation of the community-based video approach. Yes, this video is very, very interesting. You know, like we can see how the community identifies themselves with the characters featured in the video, where they're able to relate themselves. And the most part of the behavior change takes place when they are able to relate themselves in the people who are featuring in the video. And I think that's the most successful part of this approach. And I thank you, Vishal, for bringing that aspect of this video in your briefing. And I think it is very important to know that. And as we move forward, as the states plan to scale and sustain this approach, and it is very important to understand what is the essence of this video in the whole approach. Thank you so much. And now we will go on to the panel questions. And the first question, we would have a common question for all of the panelists, the implementing partners in the state. And the second question we will have very specific to each of the partners as per their, the role in the scale and sustainability of this approach. So the first question, I would ask the NHM Uttarakhand director to come forward to answer this question. Yeah, sorry, I think there was some technical glitches here. I'm sorry, I'm not able to view the screen. Dr. Sarojini, my question to you is like, how did you find the community video approach useful as you kind of introduced it in the National Health Mission of Uttarakhand? What made you to kind of try this approach with the ASHAs in the Uttarakhand National Health Mission? And how do you see the frontline workers using this approach as part of their IPC work that they are doing in the community?
Okay, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure being a part of the panel discussion. And to be very honest, in my 31 years of career, I have found that videos and films and are a great way of communicating and motivating the people on the ground. Through our people, it becomes much easier. Because when we talk, we may have different methods and understanding. A film, everybody has a perception, and then you can describe it. So I remember this girl from when I was in Haridwar as CMO. I met this this particular group of people, Digital Green, and. By that time, the Pico projectors were already distributed to a block of ANAMs, a block of ASHAs, which I sort of said that it's no use giving to a block. I think you should distribute to all the ASHA facilitators. And that ASHA facilitator, when she goes with her ASHAs in the village, she can pass the message with their help, I found it was really very good. And in fact, I am of the opinion that, in fact, I motivated most of my districts giving this small projector. I found the cost also. It was costing somewhere around 5,000 or something. And I told my districts, you can go ahead and buy for your ANMs and things like that. But we are lucky that under NHM, we've supplied enough tablets to all our districts, because there were some costing issues. So we've supplied almost 8,000 tablets, of which 6,000 have gone to ASHA all over the districts of Uttarakhand, to our CHOs, that is the mid-level health providers of Ayushman Health and Wellness Centers, to all the ANMs of Uttarakhand, that is 847 ANMs of Uttarakhand. So, in fact, I met this digital green girl, I think Sudha, and I told her, I'll take all the films from you and make some more for us and help us put onto those tablets. And we want our people to know more about it. So I would say this is very amazing. And we request you to make more videos so that, you know, people go about it, because that is the only thing. Communication is the main thing to turn around. Yes, it takes time, but on and on and on, again and again, it's going to help. So that's all from my side. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. I now pass on this question to Mr. Ravi Shankar Shukla, the National Health Mission Director of Jharkhand. So how do you see this approach, the community-based video approach introduced in Jharkhand, and has part of the IPC activities that the ASHAs, the SAIYAs are doing in the state, and how do you see this approach is helping the interpersonal communication work that the SAIYAs are doing in the state of Jharkhand as part of the National Health Mission?
Let me take this opportunity to thank you for having me here, and at the same time to congratulate the team of Digital Green for the kind of work that they have been doing extensively in the field. To take up the question, it has been already discussed, videos are definitely very powerful information tools. The kind of impact that something which we have seen creates both to our conscious as well as to our subconscious mind is something which lasts for a longer duration and more impactful. So yes, I will agree to the point that it's a very good way of disseminating the information, and especially among the public, where you may find the awareness level a bit low, where you may find that the subject, though of importance, but may appear to be a bit boring to some of the participants. So it's very important that we find new creative ways, and that is where this approach is definitely very helpful. It's easy to disseminate, and at the same time, the experience that we have seen from field in terms of the use of Pico projectors, they are very handy as well. And today, in the era of WhatsApp and other social media platforms, where these messages have the potential to be circulated in the video mode to all the households. So that is another good gain of the technology that we are using. And it has the potential of being tailor-made to address any particular situation, any particular theme. So the flexibility, the adaptability is also important here. So overall, I agree with what earlier panelist has remarked, that this is definitely very useful, and not only on a theoretical level, but also based upon the experience that we have got from the field.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And the next panelist that we have to answer this question is Mr. Jagadananda. This is a very unique partnership that we have in the state of Odisha with the CYST, the organization to which he represents. This is an NGO which has adopted this approach and implementing this in their project area in the health and nutrition work that they have been doing. So it is very interesting to see how the same approach which we were implementing with our government partners is also has relevance to do with the NGO partner in their ongoing activity. And yes, sir, Mr. Jagannanda, we would like to know from you, how did you find this approach useful in the work that you've been doing in the field within the community to whom you've been serving? Because you've been working with the tribal dominated regions of Odisha and the most backward areas in the state of Odisha. So how did you find this approach useful for you in terms of disseminating it in the community and also producing these videos with the help of the extension workers that you have in your program? Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Vijay. I think it is an amazing program, actually, let me tell you. Because, you know, it depends on the kind of place where you are implementing it. As you rightly said, CYST believes in reaching the hard to reach areas. So places which are acutely, you know, problematic for both government and for the civil society organizations. Places which are hard to reach areas, communication is a problem, etc., tribal dominated. You know, we have very little time, but let me tell you, you know, we have picked up those districts which can be compared to any backward regions of the world, actually. And, you know, and they get covered under the Signing India campaign. So working in those hard to reach pockets is a bonus for us and a bonus in this program. So the need is acutely there. The problem is very well recognized by the government, because if malnutrition, although we are doing on malnutrition front, the state average and the national average is close by. But when you go to the details, the devil is in the details. And those districts are really so bad. They're double almost. If they are asked, you know, the state average is almost 30%. These districts should be about 50%. So they get covered under the average data, actually. Data, you know, they hide around the data sets. So having selected those places, I think our first allies are the extension workers of the government. They see so much values in this deep dive, what you call extension program, when peer-to-peer community intervention is taking place, and there is very little leakage, because the quality assurance visit and the real-time monitoring which we are doing is really making all of us alert at every time, actually. Round two, round four, round six. If we see round two, the kind of effort we have made and the result we achieved, in round four, in some areas we lost some tempo. In round six, we picked up because we are able to monitor that. And then on the extension workers, CYST believes to work both at the supply side and at the demand side. Because we believe if the community is not organized, if the community is not very aware about their own entitlement, if the community is not seeing value of their problems and then a way out to deal with their problems, I think that is the demand side of our work. The supply side is when the community gets aware, and if the supply side is not organized and they don't see, they're not sensitive to meet the needs, then there is a problem. So in this piece of work, we are working at the demand side and supply side. The extension workers of the government, our extension volunteers, they work hand in hand. And when you go to the primary health center, the community health center, you know, the doctors and the medical officers there and the district CDMOs, they become our greatest allies, because they see their targets are fulfilled so easily. And there is a, you know, what you call, they see a lot of result-driven work in this very intensive process. So because of that, there are two other departments in the state government who have identified CYST as their knowledge partners. Of course, the health department, we are pushing, they are busy in the pandemic, but I'm sure that will also eventually come. And finally, what one thing I would like to say, you know, in the during the pandemic, the piece of work which we did with Digital Green together, in you know, in this and the WhatsApp messages, the interactive radio work, and the kind of peer education materials which were produced, the videos, they were so helpful during the pandemic. The three P's, whether it is you know, the SMS, whether it is you know, sanitization, hand washing, the mask work, or the physical distancing, the messaging in these areas and beyond that became very, very easy actually for both government, for the community, and the acceptability is so high that, you know, you don't have to talk to them on sanitization of hands actually. They're already convinced. And because they're convinced by their peer in the nearby village. So the technique is amazing actually. And then this real-time monitoring has really helped us and to engage the community over health and nutrition entitlements so that the supply side is more responsive. The final point is we are using also the people with disabilities, PWDs, as health champions. You know, this is a neglected, what you call, lot. And using them as health champions is another, you know, route we have taken in the recent past. And I'm sure it will pay us rich dividends as we move now. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And now we were expecting Mr. Balamurugan from Jivika to join us. Unfortunately, he is stuck in a meeting, in the board meeting, and it's continuing. So he will not be able to answer these questions in the panel. So we have a representation from Jivika, Ms. Mahua Roy Chowdhury. She's a senior member of Jivika team and oversees their governance and knowledge management functions. So we maybe we will ask Mahua Roy Chowdhury to answer this question as to how Jivika found this approach, because one of the pioneering partner that we had is Jivika, the livelihood mission, which has actually seen a value in this approach and actually piloted in the state of Bihar in few districts, and then they scaled now to the entire state. So we would like to hear from you, Mahua, what actually has been your experience in this approach when you started, and how you went on scaling this. Yes, please, go ahead, over to you, Mahua.
Thank you so much, Vijay. So we started working with Digital Green in 2012 itself. And we first started with community videos on agriculture front and majorly on farming techniques. And we found this community videos to be very, very effective because the community videos were being prepared by the community themselves. So we started training our community resource persons who were, you know, villagers themselves, who were all members of the self-help groups. So we developed a pool of community video developers or producers, and we also developed a pool of community dissemination, video dissemination teams in various districts. So at that time, we were working in seven districts, and gradually we moved to all the 38 districts of Bihar. And today we are having we have moved on from preparing community videos on farm techniques to livestock, to insurance components, to institution building, and also to the health and nutrition aspects. So we have moved to all the themes of in which the livelihood mission works on. And we found this entire process to be very, very empowering at the local level, because our community members could relate when a community member herself was presenting her best practices. So this was done in a massive manner. And by 2016 itself, we had around 500 community videos prepared by Jivika community members themselves, and they were disseminating them these works as well. And then we started working on institutionalizing the process. And what we did was we tried to map, or we do a lot of community trainings. So we are working on 13 thematic areas, and you know, all the three livelihood sectors, all four in fact, job skills, livestock, farm-based, and also non-farm-based livelihoods. Then we have financial inclusion as a major part, then IBCB, which is our community architecture, institutional architecture, where we have self-help groups, promotion of village organization, and also cluster level federations. So we started working on preparing these community videos as a training tool. And then we tried to map all these videos with the training modules. And then we introduced them, we took them up with our community resource persons who were basically disseminating, giving trainings, and as well as mandatorily were disseminating videos. Because when you are establishing a concept on a training, then immediately after that, if you have a video following through, then the adoption rates improves a lot. So in that manner, we've started working on this. And at this moment, we also capitalized ourselves on making the processes more enabling by providing the infrastructure. So we again thought that only community video is not going to work. We started integrating in three major aspects. A community video, which is disseminated in a group of 20 to 25 women. But then to nudge that entire process, we are now sending IVR messages. Again, we have partnered with Onion Dev, and then we are also nudging the entire process by IVR messaging. Followed by that, we are also sending SMS alerts, and then we have a call center where if the people have any problem or any doubt on a message, then they can call back, and that's also a toll-free number. And within 2 days, our health experts are providing those answers. So we have come a full circle in this entire process by using community videos, by using IVR messaging, and also SMS alerts. So the entire COVID period also, and you know, in Bihar, we have another very tragic symptom of AES in Muzaffarpur. So in those areas also, we started giving messages on AES symptoms, what to do on them. And then we did a survey on this, and we found out that after sending these messages to them and sending messages through WhatsApp groups and also videos through YouTube channels, what we could do is achieve through an again IVR study is saying that around 60% of them were able to answer the right symptoms of AES. They were able to answer whom to approach first when such symptoms are coming, what first precautionary things needs to be done. So these were very, very encouraging, and we are seeing results not only in the health, nutrition, and sanitation aspects, but we are seeing results in many other aspects also. And that is the reason we discussed the entire process with our Honorable Chief Minister, who was very excited, and then he said that we should take up these programs more and more. And today we have already invested over $2 million in procuring Pico projectors. And today we have at least one Pico projector in each panchayat. That's the way that we are going. We work with 100,000 community resource persons who are using these Pico projectors to disseminate the information, the messages, and also various knowledge aspects to our community members through community videos, through community messaging systems. So that has been the scale that we have working in Bihar.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Mahua. It's a very, very impressive story that you are saying in the state of Bihar, how the community-based video approach has actually expanded to layering various technology platforms, you know, to reiterate the messages that is being provided through the community-based video. And it's in an integrated way that you've been providing. And I think it's a very good story to say, and people to learn from it. Thank you so much. And I think we are running late by 13 minutes. I think for the next question, I would ask the panelists to be two to three minutes to answer the questions, and we'll try to be on time. Yeah, thank you so much. And the next question I would again want to post it to Jeevika. Ms. Mahua, maybe you can answer this question again. Jeevika has been using this approach for quite some time. What is your plan for scale and sustainability, and also how you can, you know, like you have been doing this for a longer period than any other states. What is your plan to kind of, you know, knowledge management of this approach? Is there a plan to kind of share your learnings to other states which are trying to use this approach for scale or sustainability? So what is your plan for knowledge management, and also what is your plan for scale and sustainability and making it within your ongoing program for further investments into it?
Yeah, thank you, Vijay, again. Yeah, we are already in a process of institutionalizing the entire process and scaling it up. Actually, in 2011 itself, we realized the potential of this, and then we moved on. And from then itself, we were in a process of evolution, and we moved on to various other themes apart from our agriculture videos that we initiated with. At this moment, we are basically working on an MIS application, a software where we are trying to post in all our community videos. We are trying to also map or do an inventory of all the Pico projectors and also the cameras that are available with us, so that we can track that which is, what is the capacity that in that at which the Pico projectors are being used at different levels, and the potentiality of it. And we can also gauge various progress at that level. We can also gauge which Pico projector or which particular you know, camera needs servicing and maintenance and things like that. So this is one area that we are working on. On the other area, we are actually working on an annual action plan of developing a training calendar and also dissemination calendar, video production calendar as well. So we are having more of the resource pool coming in. So in each of the 38 districts that we are working, we are basically training 10 community resource persons for video production and 10 more on video dissemination. So that's the pool that we are, each district is going to have. And then apart from that, we are also training 10 more on story writing and also going for formative research sort of a process, so that they can bring in more of best practices on board, and that can be added up in the training calendar. So we have an entire process built up in this manner. We have also a communication manager placed in every district who are basically anchoring it in their district. So that's the whole plan of institutionalizing and scaling it up in this manner. If we are talking about the knowledge dissemination or knowledge management part in various other states or other two other developmental agencies, for that, we've been notified as a national resource organization, and our community resource persons and also various other officials have been moving in to various states, and they also use these community videos to disseminate and provide training out there. So we have been moving in Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Jharkhand, and our community resource persons, when they were training the community resource persons of Jharkhand, Rajasthan, and UP, they were using Pico projectors to do that, or they were using the community videos to do that. So that the entire process of knowledge exchange is already there and already built in. And we are going to do more on this, because we are also thinking of, we do come up with learning note series. And in the recent learning note series, we do have a component of community video as a special chapter for our next learning note series.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Mahua. The next question we will have to Dr. Saroj Nathani. Ma'am, you are implementing this approach in two districts currently, and you plan to saturate in these two districts with the help of Digital Queen. But the project is ending in another 6 months, and you started much later than other states. So what is your plan to scale it in other districts, this approach, and how do you think you can sustain it on your own with the support that currently that Digital Green is providing you for implementation, for the procurement of Pico Projector, and also training that that currently you get support from Digital Green? How do you plan to scale and sustain this effort in your state?
See, let me tell you one thing, that we do need hand-holding, because sometimes we just, you know, procurement is very not so difficult sometimes, but once the equipment comes, how it is to be used, how the people are to be trained is very important. So the first and foremost is that we do need hand-holding. So even if the project is coming to an end, we'll have to see how USAID and other development partners pitch in to help Uttarakhand, because we do have a difficult terrain in terms of, in every way. Like, we have a mixed type of population, we have aspirational districts, we have high altitudes, we have remote areas, we have slums. So everything you get in Uttarakhand. So that way we would need help. That's number one thing. Number two is, as far as procurement is concerned, I already told you, to be very honest, we did not plan for any procurement because we didn't have those kind of funds. And somehow we did not budget in our NHMPIP also. But because there were certain discussions going on, and as I told you, we already have so many tablets and smartphones in the districts, and more are to come. So almost more than 50% of the of our health workers, the frontline workers who work from sub-center down below, the ASHAs and all, they already have all these equipment. So if we can, with your help, get those videos installed into their equipment, and it would work not as a Pico projector, of course, they are instruments which can show these films. So that would be a great help. And because it's not about only taking the films and putting the chip onto the laptop or your smartphone or a tablet and just showing the film. It is also about capacity building of my staff in terms of knowledge upgradation. So I would also request whatever films they are showing, apart from that, we could have certain training modules as well, because this is very, I think I saw one of the modules of family planning. And recently, when we were in the NPCC of Uttarakhand in Nirman Bhavan on 17th and 18th, of course, we knew our unmet need is very high. So I was just thinking, if you could help us with more videos. We do have pockets where there are still home deliveries. So why institutional delivery is more important? So I would need the support of the unit for capacity building as well. And videos, as said. So I think that's all from my side. So I do need support. So because Uttarakhand is one state, so many times they say, your indicators are still better than districts like Uttar Pradesh and Bihar and other states. But no, it's not like that. Two districts, Haridwar and Udham Singh Nagar, have their issues. Hills have their own issues. And at present, my maternal mortality has gone up by 10 points. It was 89 per lakh last year. Last year, which we just doing, our death audit is very, very, very good. So we had 10 extra deaths in 1 lakh population. So how we get our SDGs is again going to be difficult. Although our IMR is 31, better than India average, but still it is not so good. We would like to touch as good as Kerala and Tamil Nadu. So I think we need your help. So I think you got to decide. So I need to scale up. And gradually we'll see, as per if we feel we need procurement for some Pico projectors at the headquarters or something like that, we can work on that as well. That's not a big amount. They're very easy to purchase, but for training, capacity building, we need handholding. Yes, thank you so much. All over Uttarakhand, not only two districts, all over Uttarakhand. Because when you do in pockets, it doesn't help much. It has to be, and ours is a small state, just 13 districts with 1.14 CR population. So I think we can work on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Doctor. I think it's important that we create some institutional mechanisms within the state to kind of scale and sustain this effort. I think Digital Green will work with you to develop that institutional mechanism to take this forward in your state. Thank you so much. And then now we will move to Mr. Ravi Shankar Shukla. Jharkhand recently has approved the sustainability plan that Digital Green has provided. So what is your plan in terms of scale and sustainability? If you look at it in Jharkhand, we have, including the NHM, we have three partners using this approach. We have the livelihood mission using this approach, and also we have the nutrition mission through the ICDS using this approach, and also the National Health Mission. And what do you see as a collaborating factor between all the three partners who are implementing this approach in the state, and how you see scaling this approach in the state? Definitely, I think you have always been including the procurement of Pico Projector in the PIP, and many times it has not been approved. And so we would like to hear from you, like how you are planning to scale this up and make this approach more as a part of the SAIA's ongoing interpersonal communication activities. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, very valid point. The convergence between the nutrition mission, health mission, and GSLPS group, that has increased over the time, because the area of work is, and as well as the stakeholders, the participants are similar. And again, the mandate is also quite overlapping to an extent. So there has been collective learning for all the partners, all the participants. And the utilization of Pico Projector in terms of it's being relatively more handy, and in a way to say that it's something which can be replicated with ease, and it doesn't require that much of technical know-how. So that has been there. And as you rightly pointed out, that the proposal were given time and again in the PIP, but was not approved. So now what could be the way forward? So we are thinking both in terms of covering it through the state budget, and at the same time, with the help of some partner agencies as well. And when you speak of upscaling, I mean, considering the fact that as of now, there are only four districts where Digital Green is actively providing its services with respect to both training as well as coordinating the efforts in the area of maternal health and related areas. So first part of scaling up would be to increase it in a way that we may saturate all the 24 districts of the state. The second way of scaling would be to cover more and more frontline workers. So as of now, for example, we are covering SAIAs. So even in the blocks where we are working, there are some SAIAs who are still left out. So saturating all the SAIAs as the frontline workers. And when it comes to other sectors like GSLPS or social welfare, nutrition mission, so covering them as well, we have a very vibrant adolescent age group related project, which is run under the name of the Yashwini Project. So that is also equally important and a very important age group as well to address the issues. Similarly, the third part of scaling up could be in terms of maybe adopting new methodologies, and new methodologies from both point of views, from the point of view of training of our frontline workers, and from the point of view of sharing the existing knowledge with the help of our frontline workers, ensuring that existing awareness is spread about in an equal and sustainable manner among the beneficiaries as well. So these may be some of the possible areas when we think of scaling up the entire project. And again, the project has been limited mostly to maternal health and other related issues. ANC and related areas have been covered. So if we can develop some more thematic videos and thematic ideas to be disseminated. For example, there are several districts of the state which are Kalajar endemic, and there are most of the districts are LF endemic. And again, adolescent health, as I pointed out earlier, more interventions with respect to ANC, and now with the emerging concept of health and wellness center and Jan Arogya Samiti, maybe involving these new emerging areas as well. So these could be some of the ideas or some of the working models which we may consider for scaling up the initiatives which have been taken already.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
I think you made a very right point, and you also, we see that you really have a systematic plan for scale and sustainability of this approach in your state. And we appreciate that, and we would be happy to support you through Digital Green for whatever support you would require in the next 6 months that before the project ends. Thank you so much. So we were supposed to have Sunita Kadiala from London School to summarize the panel discussion, but unfortunately she had to attend a class and she has to leave. She has posted her thoughts in the chat box on the thoughts that she had to share. People who wanted to look at it, maybe look at the chat section for her thoughts on that. And now I think we can have the question and answer session from the from the participants. If you have any questions, please raise your questions. I think, Daniel, you have been posting a lot of questions in the chat box. Do you want to ask any of those questions?
Vijay, I think there has been a number of questions in the chat bot as well as in the question and answer, which has already been answered. So perhaps we can move on. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. I think we can move on to the next session. I think Krishnan, you need to provide the valedictory, right?
Yeah. That's right. Thank you so much, Vijay. Well, apologies because this interesting discussion went beyond the originally planned time, but we are quite happy and quite grateful to the participants for the patience and as well as the panelists who were with us throughout, right? Want to thank Sangeeta Patel, Director, Health Office, USAID, for taking her time from her busy schedule and then addressing this webinar at the start. Of course, Dr. Sunita, Professor Sunita Katlaya, Professor Global Nutrition from LHSTM. She couldn't spend more time with us, but she has shared some very interesting thoughts in the chat box, which is of importance to us. And she has also shared some resources. Thanks to LHSTM for being a partner in this whole process. Jagadanandaji, one of the tallest leaders in the civil society you'll find, the founder and mentor of CVSD. I mean, his words are always refreshing, always motivating. And thank you for taking your time to be with us. Mahua Roy Chaudhary from Jivika. I mean, she was incredibly eloquent in terms of outlining not only what Jivika has done so far, but also what Jivika plans to do in the coming days. And it has been a fabulous experience for us to work with Jivika. And we look forward to continuing this partnership in the days to come. Okay. Ravi Shankar Shuklaji from Jharkhand, MD NHM. Your words were encouraging for us, motivating for us. And this is a partnership that we cherish. And we do look forward in the days to come to address some of those challenges that you mentioned and how together we can actually work moving forward. Dr. Saroj Nathani, MD, NHM from Uttarakhand. It is this association, this engagement, this partnership that we have with partners like you that keeps us going. And nothing is more encouraging for us than the confidence and the commitment that is shown by our partners in this community-based video approach. And what we generally find is that, this is one approach which can be applied to any sector without any hesitation. And quite interestingly, the cost of investing in scaling up this approach is quite minimal compared to other traditional ways of social behavioral change communication. So it's a commitment from Digital Green side to see how we can actually build the system's capacity in working with our partners across different states and help you to realize your mission in a much better, efficient way. So that's what we are here for, and we will continue to provide that. Also to Vishal, who told us the story of how these videos are generated and how actually the pulses of people are taken into consideration while putting together this video at different points. Thank you, Vishal. And of course, no words can sufficiently express our gratitude to Vijay Paul Raj from USAID. Vijay, you have been a friend, you have been a critic, you have been a great supporter of not only Digital Green, but various other institutions who are engaged in social behavioral change. And your association and your partnership for us is worth its weight in gold. Right. Thank you so much for being with us. And we do look forward to work with you in the days to come also. My special thanks to Farhad and the Samvad team for putting together this excellent webinar. And of course, my colleagues like Susan, Shiny, and all those who worked behind the scenes. Once again, thanks everyone. Your words were incredibly powerful and inspiring for many of us. There are so many queries that has come from our audience, and we will reach out to each one of you separately. And with this, want to wish you a wonderful evening, a wonderful day ahead, and depending upon which part of the country you are in. And we do look forward to work with you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And thanks for organizing such a wonderful session, Digital Green.
Thank you.
Thank you, Krishna.